Today's platform is called Artistic Activism with Steve Duncombe. Steve Duncombe is professor of media and culture at New York University and the author of and editor of 6 books, including Dream, Reimagining Progressive Politics in an Age of Fantasy, and The Art of Activism. He is also the creator of the Open Utopia, an open access, open source, web-based edition of Thomas More's Utopia. Duncombe is a lifelong political activist and the co-founder of the Center for Artistic Activism, a research and teaching institute that trains activists to think more like artists and artists to think more like activists. Please welcome Steve Duncombe.
Thank you, and thank you for coming to hear me. I've gone past this building for 35 years when I first moved here, when I was 20 years old, and I've never been inside. I go to the New York Historical Society, I go to the museum, I go fishing across the park every Sunday, and I've never been here. So this is a real treat for me, and it's a real treat to say a few words for you. Let's see if we can get this going. Oh, of course it... There we go, hello. I have this wonderful introduction, so I don't need to introduce myself, so I'm going to just sort of launch right into this. I have a life as a college professor. It's my day job. But ever since the early 90s, late 80s, I've also been an activist. And I worked with Lower East Side Collective down in Lower Manhattan. And working as an activist in Lower Manhattan in the 1980s and 1990s, I was surrounded by artists. And so one of the things that I started to realize is how much art could actually lend to activism and how much activism could actually lend to art as well, and become a very powerful dynamic. As a scholar, one of the things I was interested in is, well, who's been doing this? And I realized people have been doing this for millennia. And they've been doing this all around the world. But about 10 years ago, I co-founded with an artist, Steve Lambert, something called the Center for Artistic Activism, and we travel around the world working with artists and activists and most recently investigative journalists, every place from Russia to Australia. We've been doing a lot of work in West Africa and the Western Balkans over the past 3 years. But essentially, again, working with artists and getting to strategize a little bit more like activists and getting activists to be creative like artists. We work on a range of issues. We're relatively ecumenical that way. Of course, there's some things we won't work on. And what we try to do is we run these workshops for about a week in which we talk about the theory, we talk about history, and we actually create a project together over the course of 24 hours. And then those people go on to do their own work. And we actually stay in contact with them over years. And one of the great things about doing this work is to find people 10 years down the line doing these incredibly creative actions, things that we could have never dreamed of, and realize that there was a little seed that started one time in one place. But every time we do a workshop, we start with an introduction. We're not gonna have time to do it today, but it's something called stepping off the curb. And as an activist, one of the things we're always trying to do is get people to step off the curb. And what we mean by that is we mean it both literally, how do you get people to step off the sidewalk into the street for your demonstration, your action, but also we mean it figuratively. How do you get people to step off the curb of indifference and become active citizens? And since we're working with activists and working with activist artists, investigative journalists, they all have a story about how they became an activist, okay? How they stepped off the curb. And so I've done this with probably thousands of people. If we had time, I'd do it with everybody here, but I'm asking for one volunteer who self-identifies as an activist to just tell us what was the moment in their life or moments in which they decided they wanted to step off the curb and become active. Yes.
Danny.
Hi, Danny.
I was a young man, I think in high school, and the New York Daily Mirror was still a paper. If the New York Post is now the most conservative paper, the Mirror was to the right of the Daily
Mirror. The Post was liberal then.
That's right.
That's
true. Yes. But the in Birmingham, when they had demonstrations and there were pictures of black human beings and the dogs, is when I knew that it was wrong and I could do something and I had to do something.
Great. I want you to remember what Danny said, because that's actually, that image is an image we're going to talk about later, okay? Now, what's interesting about what Danny said is, again, I've done this with thousands of people all around the world. Everybody has a different story. Yet there's some things these stories all have in common. One of the things is what activists don't say. Activists never say they became an activist by signing a petition, or by receiving a pamphlet, or by reading a white paper, or watching a press conference, or reading a news story, watching a PSA, going to a lecture, attending a meeting, email forward, or retweeting a tweet. Okay? But I worked as an activist, and that's what we did most of the time. Instead, the stories they tell are much more like Danny's. They're things which are experiential. I remember being in high school, and I saw this picture, okay? They tend to be emotional. I knew it was wrong. They tend to be affective experiences, okay? Things which move them to a path of justice, okay? Sometimes it can be through an image, okay? Often it can be through a direct experience. Sometimes it's a lifetime of experiences. We did a lot of work with sex workers in South Africa, and when we did this exercise, one woman said, I'm poor, I'm black, I'm a lesbian, and I'm a sex worker. There's not a moment in my life when I've actually been on with her, right? It was an experience of her life that led her to become a sex worker advocate and activist. Now, for activist communications, this is a problem, because we're trained to do things like put together press releases, put together press conferences. That's what I did when I was a paid activist. But luckily, there's a communication strategy that has been around for about 10,000 years. Every once in a while, they discover a new cave and push it back a couple thousand years, that actually works on the experiential and emotional and affective register. And of course, what I'm talking about is art, okay? And that's why it's so powerful. I am not an artist. I am an activist. I became an artistic activist because I was convinced that it actually makes for more effective activism, because it's more affective activism. So what I want to do in the brief time we have together is give you some examples. I always think it's best to actually not speak abstractly, but show examples of artistic activism. And then I want to show artistic activism, a very brief presentation about artistic activism in something that people might not think of as an artistic movement, which was the U.S. Civil Rights Movement from 1955 to 1965, which was very consciously thought of in terms of culture and symbols and so on and so forth. And I do want to bring up exactly that image that you're talking about, Danny. And then if we have time, we'll talk a little bit about how to think theoretically about arts and activism. But if we don't get there, that's fine as well. All right? So here we go. What is artistic activism? One of the things I've done is created a database of examples of artistic activism that's user-generated. We now have 2,500 examples from around the world, and new ones get put up every day. So we could be here for months. I've just picked five. Not that because they're the best, but just because I find them interesting, and it gets at some of the range of what we think of as artistic activism. I'm going to start with a project by an artist named Candy Shang. And Candy Shang was living in New Orleans when Hurricane Katrina hit. And as the floodwaters receded, you had all these houses and businesses that were boarded up. And at the same time, there was lots of discussions about how to rebuild New Orleans. And one of the things that Candy started to realize is the people being asked how to rebuild New Orleans were politicians, real estate developers, urban experts, but no one was asking the people who actually lived in the neighborhoods what they wanted to rebuild. And so she did something super simple, and that's why I love this project. She made up name tags. You know, as though my name is. But instead it says, I wish this was. And then she just put them on all these boarded up buildings. And what ended up happening is people started to fill them in. And it became this sort of public discussion, this public forum of what a rebuilt New Orleans could be. I wish this could be a butcher shop, a bakery, a grocery, I love this, with fresh produce and pumpkin pie. Very specific about this person. A grocery, locally owned. Community center, three boats, bookstore, cafe, real soul food, something different, a city without theft, a Chinese restaurant. I wish this was a home. And the efficacy of this practice is unknown, okay? She didn't work in conjunction with a group that was actually working to try to bring the public into the planning process, but it sparked an imagination. It sparked a space in which people started to say, why am I not being consulted? I have ideas, and I live here. I know this neighborhood better than anybody else. Very simple, very low-key, probably cost her a couple hundred dollars, but open to space for imagination. The next one is on a much larger scale. This happens in Bogota, Colombia. Bogota, Colombia is a city that was known for many things. One of them was traffic deaths, okay? And there was this really innovative mayor who was elected, Antonis Macas. Oh, sorry. It's my habit to walk around. Antonis Macas. And he was a former philosophy professor. And he said, we're approaching all these problems way too conservatively. Let's be bold. But because he was a college professor, he sent out a survey of the people of Bogota about why people weren't respecting traffic laws. It's sort of a little like New York. And what he found out is that it had nothing to do with legality, because most of the traffic police were corrupt and would shake down people. So more laws, more fines wasn't going to work. But what people in Bogota did care about was face, respect, saving face. And so what he did is he fired the entire 270-person traffic force of Bogota and hired in their place mimes. And the mimes directed traffic. And instead of fining people, they ridiculed people. They made fun of people. If you ran a stop sign, they would go up and knock on your door and wag their finger at you. And they'd get people to laugh at people. And traffic fatalities dropped by 50%. Now, what's interesting about this is it was so effective in Bogota that it traveled to Caracas in Venezuela, and it didn't work there. And it says something about the specificity of the practice of artistic activism. What works in Nairobi doesn't work in New Jersey. What works in Caracas doesn't work in Bogota, and vice versa. It always has to do with the specificity of the culture. We can learn from these, but reproducing it never, never works. That's why we don't teach tactics. We don't teach people how to do a flash mob or something of that nature. We teach people how to work within their own communities, map out the cultural resources of their communities, and make their own tactics. One of which we'll talk about. Okay. I'm actually not going to introduce this other than to say that this took place in Helsinki during HIV awareness at Pride Week. About HIV awareness, I'm sorry, during Pride Week in Helsinki. I think it speaks for itself, even though it's in Finnish, which I assume nobody speaks. Okay. Now, he could have stood up on a soapbox and lectured about, you know, you can't, oh, he could have stood on a soapbox and lectured about you can't get HIV through human, through skin-to-skin contact. There we go. Ah, that's amazing. Okay. He could have stood on a soapbox and harangued people about what it's like to live with HIV. Instead, he did a very simple performative gesture, leveraging empathy, to say all of that without actually saying it at all. And that's the, one of the real powers of using artistic activism. Like all good art, it actually makes you feel something, ask questions more than tells you something. And in doing that, the audience comes away with something which is theirs, or which they've shared with you. And this is a beautiful example of that in practice. This is actually a practice that did reproduce itself. One of the people that was in one of our workshops in Accra, in Ghana, did a very similar one in the main shopping mall in Accra, because he was struggling with mental illness. And he did the same thing of sitting up and saying, I have mental illness, which is not talked about in his community, and asked people not to hug him, but to come and talk to him. Okay, so he changed it a little bit, but the same sort of just bearing witness gesture worked effectively in Accra as well. I don't know in New York if it would work. In any case, okay. This is the 24-hour museum. And if that was, again, a very simple gesture, this is a much more complicated one. Alfredo Yar is an artist and architect from Chile, who actually lives in New York now. But at this time, he went to Skogal, Sweden. He was asked to come to Skogal, Sweden. And anybody been to Skogal? No one I know has ever been to Skogal, even when we've done this in Sweden. It's a town that's far out, and they in the sort of the woods. And what they do is it's a lumber town, and they use the lumber to chip it up and make paper, that heavy sort of paper used for milk cartons and so on and so forth. Anyways, Alfredo Yar was asked to come to the town and do an art exhibit. He's a fairly well-known artist. And he got there, and he looked around, and he said, okay, so you have saunas paid for by the company and the social democratic state of Sweden. You have schools. You have history museums. You have this beautiful city hall. But you don't have a museum. So what I want to do is build a museum. And so he built a museum. Again, he was trained as an architect. And he, everybody brought in their artwork. It was a museum for people to show their artwork in the town. People brought in their artwork. They had a grand opening. There's the mayor cutting the ribbon. They've got an Oompa band, and there they are. If you can see in the middle, it says, it's hard to see in this light, it says 24-hour museum. And people started to say, well, why is this called 24-hour museum? Is it open for 24 hours? And he said, no, it's because after 24 hours, I'm going to burn it to the ground. And that's what he did. He burned it to the ground and then left for New York. Now, this is kind of messed up, right? Except Alfredo, we talked to him about this, and we said, what did you do? Why did you do this? And he said, but the story doesn't end there. 6 weeks later, he's in New York, and he gets a call. And it's from the mayor of Skogal, Sweden. And he says, for the first time in the history of the town, the people mobilized themselves to demand something of us that wasn't given by the company, it wasn't provided by the social welfare state. They organized themselves, and they demanded something. And what they demanded was a museum. And we said, Alfredo, that's brilliant, but how do you know it was going to work? And he goes, didn't. And he says half the same stuff doesn't work. And part of this is it is a risky strategy. When we work with activist organizations, we do a lot of work, for example, with Greenpeace. And one of the things that we always say is, like, don't give up lobbying. Don't give up knocking on doors. This is a risky strategy, but when it pays off big. And the risk is actually part of the endeavor itself. I want to end this before we move into the historical section, with an example of one that we worked with. Remember I said during our workshops, the last 24 hours, we plan, brainstorm, plan, execute, and then reflect upon a creative action. Well, this was in Macedonia, or what's now known as North Macedonia. This is about 10 years ago. And 10 years ago, it was under a very repressive right-wing regime, and we were there to work with LGBTQ and Roma rights activists. At that time, Macedonia was the second only to Russia as the worst place to be queer in Europe. So it was a very, very repressive regime. And we sat down at the end of, it was a very nationalist regime, and so they, has anybody ever been to Skopje or Macedonia? It's actually a great city. I go there all the time now because we work there a lot, but it is full of the ugliest statues you've ever seen in your, and I'm talking full, like 240 statues. The right-wing government just put statues up every place, just monuments to the sort of, you know, mythic history of Alexander the Great and terrible stuff, okay? But there's monuments every place, very, at that time, they were really sort of pressing the nationalism. And we sit down and we say, okay, well, what are we gonna do? And the first impulse was, well, they want us to leave, and so we're gonna say, we're not leaving, and you get out. And, you know, kind of middle finger to those people that are giving them the middle finger, right? We're like, okay, that could work. But aren't you kind of playing into their narrative, which is you aren't real Macedonians. Real Macedonians are not queers or Roma. And they were like, yeah, that makes sense. And so they came up with this better idea, which was to create a new Macedonia. Now at that time, Macedonia could not be called Macedonia because the Greeks objected to it. So it had to be called the former Republic of Macedonia. And so they named this new world that they were going to create the future republic of the former Republic of Macedonia. And we made passports. There's gender is not a male, female. It's actually a scatter plot, and you can kind of move it around. And we built the future republic of the former Republic of Macedonia in a park on an afternoon for about 4 hours. And we had a border. We had a border guard. You'd be welcomed in, you got a little card, and you got the passport. Everybody would clap when you'd come in, and you can't see in the written in Cyrillic back there, but it says, come meet your queer neighbor, come meet your Roma neighbor. And people came in, and there was music, and there was drawings for the kids, and at the center of it all was we built a pedestal, because of course you have to have statues. But instead of statues of these big macho dudes, people stood up there and they held up this sign which says hero, heroine, and they wrote lover, teacher, parent, child, and they would take pictures of themselves and post them on Instagram and so on and so forth. By the end of the day, 500 people had become citizens of this future republic of the former Republic of Macedonia. And that was when the previous year, the gay center had been firebombed. Part of the reason this worked is because people didn't quite know what it is. They got in it, they entered it, and it was fun. It was a lot more fun than the repressive right-wing government. Interestingly enough, and there is no cause and effect here, okay? Activists and artists brought down the right-wing regime about 6 years later in this thing called the Colorful Revolution, where they just took paint and put it all over all of the statues. And now there's kind of a center-left, center-right back and forth government, and it's now called North Macedonia, and will enter the EU. But the idea was to create a dream and to create a fantasy of the world that we wanted to create, because that's one of the things that art does really well. Art is good at critique, but it's even better at imagining a future and allowing people to actually experience it and feel it, and there we are. As I said before, when I first started this, I was like, oh, wow, arts and activism. That's really interesting. It's happening in the Lower East Side. And then I was like, okay, but people have been doing it before. Wait, ACT UP. Yeah, they put arts and activism together. And then I looked back a little bit farther, and then a little bit farther, and I realized that arts and activism have gone together for millennia. When we do this lecture, I usually do a whole history section, and we start with, you know, Moses Jesus and the Prophet Muhammad, depending on who we're working with, okay? Because they actually understood how to mobilize sign, symbol, and spectacle in the service of, in that case, a religious message, but religion and politics were one and the same. We don't have time to go through all of this, so we're just gonna look at a little bit of the civil rights movement. And to talk about how they employed arts in an artistic perspective, even though they weren't artists. They were just really good activists. So, we all know this picture, right? This is Rosa Parks. As the story goes, and my kids still learn this in public school today, a tired seamstress who at the end of the day was just, had had enough and decided to not give up her seat to the white man, as was the law and custom in the South at that moment. Now, everybody in this room knows that that's not the real story, okay? Is that Rosa Parks was a trained activist. She had been trained at the Highlander Center. She was actually the secretary of the NAACP. She knew exactly what she was doing, and she did it with the full weight and muscle of the civil rights establishment and movement behind her, okay? It was not a naive act. Other people had done the same thing earlier and been arrested, but the NAACP picked Rosa Parks to become the face of their movement because she was an experienced activist, because she was older, and because they knew that they needed to create an image that was going to be sympathetic to the rest of the United States. Here's the wide shot on this. Sometimes you get this shot, sometimes you get that. Anybody know who the guy in the back is? Who do you think he is? Well, this is the thing. I always thought he was the white dude who didn't give up the seat. Yeah, you know, she didn't give up the seat for, right? Okay, but you're right, of course. Okay, which is actually he's not involved in it. He's a AP reporter, and the photographer is taking this shot and says we need to have contrast. White guy, get up there. You're going to provide the contrast. Okay, and this became the shot. Now the other thing is, when do you think the shot was taken? What? Afterwards, a year afterwards. Yes. So again, it was a staged shot. Now, does this make it not true? No. What it does is it performed reality. Okay? The thing about segregation and racial brutality and white supremacy is that it happened outside the glare of the cameras. It happened when no one was watching, just the people that were getting beaten and subjected to it were witnessing it. What the civil rights movement understood brilliantly is that that reality had to be performed in order to become an image, in order for that image to travel and become part of a story, and then that story would embarrass the US national government, who was in a Cold War with Russia, about who is the more democratic and, you know, blah, 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 in order to have impact real change. This wasn't accidental. This was completely planned. And it happened over and over again. Okay, this is probably the shot you know, Danny, okay? This is Birmingham, Alabama, 1963. SCLC, which was Martin Luther King's outfit, comes in to desegregate, a campaign to desegregate Birmingham, Alabama. Now, what most people don't know, and so these are the images, okay? These are the children being marched off to jail. This is attack dogs being just sicked on everyday people. And here's protesters being hosed down by the fire department. We know these images, okay? We've seen these images. What probably you don't know, because I didn't know until I started doing research on this, is that this was the second performance that a year earlier in Georgia, the SCLC did the same campaign, and it failed. And it failed because the police chief there quietly, nonviolently arrested everybody, spread them into different cells all across Georgia, and let them out at different times. No picture, no story, no movement. And so King and his lieutenants went back and said, okay, we're going to do this again. Where are we going to do it? And they picked Birmingham, Alabama. They picked Birmingham, Alabama for a couple of reasons. One, it had a very strong union movement, had a very strong civil rights movement. There was church bombings that were happening at that time, so it was very heightened tensions. But most of all, they picked it because of this guy, Bull Connor, okay? Bull Connor was the head of public safety. He was an out-and-out racist, former Klan member, and he had just lost an election, so he was actually a lame duck and had nothing to lose. And what they wagered was that he would overreact. They played him as a villain in a story, and he fell right into it. What they were doing is not to say that this brutality didn't happen. It did happen, but it happened as part of a narrative which the civil rights movement knew that they needed to get out of the South, get out of the United States, and get in front of the world stage in order for the federal government to act. And 1 year later, because of this and many other things, the Civil Rights Act was passed. What they were trying to do was make the visible, invisible, visible. So many of our problems, things like structural racism, for example, white supremacy in the South at that point, climate change, are hard to visualize, they're hard to see, they're happening at different time frames, they're happening outside the public gaze. So one of the things that artistic activism can do is make the invisible visible. Make it something that can be communicated. Make it something that can be shared. Final thing, I'll end with King. Probably like most kids, at least, you know, when I was growing up, we had to learn I Have a Dream in school, and I read it dutifully. I never thought much about it. And then a couple of years ago, I went back and read it again and realized what a mind-blowingly masterful piece of work it is. Because it starts out as critique, kind of lays out a critique of white supremacy and how it manifests itself in the United States. And then using religious imagery, using civic language, he starts to create an image of the future, and it's quite hallucinatory, okay? What King understood, if you look at that speech as not a political speech, but a performative act, is that what art can do, what a speech like that can do, is it can criticize, it can point out the failed promises of the United States, but it can do something else that's maybe more powerful, which is conjure up the image of a world to be. In other words, what it can do is it can create a dream. I do have some more. I think I'm going to end it at this point, and because it's a good stopping point as any. Okay, so thank you for having me.
So are we going to do questions? Okay, so we're going to do some questions now. For those of you here in Ceremonial Hall, please wait for the wireless microphone here. For everyone who is on Zoom, if you have a question or a comment, please type it in the chat, and I will read it out here. Thank you.
How do you connect with or find the groups around the world?
It's some of them. Some groups find us. So, for example, Greenpeace found us, and they said, "We understand what you're doing. We'd like to work with you." Sometimes we have active collaborations. We've been working with around this Free the Vaccine campaign, in which we're working with a student group who works on access to medicines, and we've just known them for a long time, and so on and so forth. But for a lot of these, we were partnered with organizations through Open Society Foundation, George Soros, who has a worldwide network of activist groups. And what they would say is, there's these folks which are doing this sort of work. Would you like to do a workshop with them? And they would say, yes. And then we would go down and we'd work with them. So that's pretty much. And now, of course, at this point, because a lot of those people we worked with then go work with other organizations, work with other organizations, it kind of snowballs out a little bit. And now the really neat thing is what we've been doing in the West Balkans and West Africa is training trainers who are now training their own trainers to create essentially you know, centers for artistic activism, but they're not called that in the Western Balkans, in West Africa, not just in West Africa, in one in Guinea, one in Senegal, one in Ghana, one in Macedonia, one in Bosnia, and so on and so forth, which is great because, as I said before, so much of this work depends upon local cultural specificity, and to have people on the ground that are working in those communities means it always works better.
I would just like to thank you for that presentation, and I'd like to mention that this Biden's idea of we are the United States of America, we're not Republicans, we're not Democrats. Well, clearly, this is a dream, okay? Obviously, there's Fox News, there's MSNBC, there's liars, there's truth tellers. So we have a divided country, but he says, we are not Republicans, we are not Democrats, we are one country. That's a dream. And he's trying to establish this Build Back Better. That's another dream. Mm-hmm. And thank you for that idea. And I think Biden's using it very effectively.
Yeah, although I do think he took that idea from Obama, who, remember, Obama's first speech was all about we're not a red state, we're not a blue state, so on and so forth. But I think both of them are working off of, you know, a standard political playbook, which I think is really smart, which is you can get very far by hate and division. I mean, look around the world today, go back in history. But you can also do it through conjuring up an ideal world. A lot of my historical work is around the New Deal, and I think the New Deal was brilliant in doing that, and not only doing that, but by employing artists to actually create this idea of an America, which was an imaginary America. The Declaration of Independence, the Constitution, it is an imaginary. There is no we the people when they write that. There's no the people, there's no we. It is a conjured up idea of a nation which does not yet exist. But they understand that one has to create this ideal in order for it to become real and then to be expanded upon.
Stephen, yeah, thanks for speaking with us today. My name's David. I've been a longtime member of Transportation Alternatives here in the city for a long
Excellent.
Time. Thanks for the thumbs up. And you're, when you spoke about the Bogota example, the mayor I recall in connection with that is also, or another mayor, is Mayor Penalosa. He was kind of self-dubbed the mayor of happiness, right? Because he made a happier city, you know, by making transit, you know, more fun and more efficient. And he created Ciclovia, I think it's called. Basically, every Sunday, all the streets would be cleared for cyclists. And so, sounds fantastic, you know. And Charles Montgomery is the author of the book Happy City. I recommend it for anyone interested in urbanism and better, you know, a better urban environment. But I'm wondering if the example of the clowns in the street kind of, you know, entertaining and shaming motorists, you know, at the same time would work here in New York, where we have the same Vision Zero. Mayor de Blasio has meant well, I really believe, but it has failed. I mean, we have a lot of casualties on our streets, worse than ever these days. And I wonder if you'd prescribe something like that, a little lighthearted for New York streets.
Yeah, no, I mean, I think that's great. As someone who biked up here and will bike down, I'm quite aware of what it's like to bike on the city streets. And, you know, I have a funny feeling that mayor may have come in after Antanas Maccas, but I don't know. And one of the things that happened is Bogota became this sort of place where you could experiment with ideas. But that's a great question of, well, this is a great question for Transportation Alternatives, which is how do you create an idea, an ideal of what a city, a safe city for bikers might look like? So I, as I mentioned, you probably were, took place in the critical mass rides for many, many years, right? And what was wonderful about that is you did critical mass, by the way, we'd meet, what was it, every third Thursday or Wednesday, something like that. And 500 bicyclists would just take over a street, and because there's so many of you, you can pretty much go wherever you want to go. And so we would go through Times Square, and there'd be no cars. Every place you'd look would be someone on a bicycle. People had these bicycles that were like five feet tall, and there'd be kids on bicycles and so on. And I always felt like that was this sort of utopian moment. It doesn't quite translate into bike lanes in an effective way, but I think that I would challenge you to do that sort of dreaming. What would an ideal city look like? I think that's exactly that moment of like get people to imagine what it could be like. I don't know, one of the things you could do is take over streets and have people just try bicycling again. Most of my friends don't bicycle because they're too afraid. They loved it when they were children, right? And now that they're too afraid. But to get that sense of this is what it could be like, maybe have the Danish consulate come in and, you know, set up a street in front of the Danish consulate about, you know, because their bike lanes are up and over, and so cars can't go on them. But we need to be able to imagine something before we can actually ask for it. You know, in that way, that's what, you know, Alfredo Jahr was engaged in, that sort of motion of imagination. Yes.
Thank you for that. Can you hear me? Yes. Thank you for that wonderful presentation. I have a question about, such a polarized world we live in, particularly because social media has been misused to represent two sides of the story only, and reality is very, very varied. What are the challenges you encounter with the groups you are working with to present these performances from a humanistic perspective rather than politicized or coming from one side of the social spectrum or political spectrum?
I mean, if you can answer that, that'd be great. I don't know. All I'm going to just throw out there is TikTok dance crazes. I think social media is primarily toxic. Yet there are, what we always try to teach people is look within popular culture for what are the progressive tendencies that you can then build off. So one of the things we do in our workshops is we go out on a cultural excursion. And everybody thinks we're going to go to a poetry reading or something like that. That's not what we do. We go to the blockbuster movie, or we go see the Chicago Cubs, or we go do whatever people who aren't activists and who aren't artists are doing that night. And then the next morning we say, what can we learn from this? Because there is no division in those places, like a wax museum, okay? Something's happening. People are finding some sort of commonality. How can we build off that? So what I would say is about social media, what happens in TikTok dance videos that makes them relatively universal? And can you politicize that in some ways? Not by politics with a capital P, introducing Republicans and Democrats and so on and so forth, but where the experience itself somehow encompasses a vision of a world without divisions. I don't know, that's almost a design problem. But I think we have to start with, what do people already enjoy doing? We could look at how screwed up this world is, and boy, is it screwed up. But there's also moments of pleasure and joy and happiness and togetherness. We just got to figure out how to leverage that, because there's always going to be the monsters who are doing the opposite.
I'm impressed by the artistic use of silence. So during the late 80s, when I was an AIDS activist, we went to the Capitol in Sacramento, California, hundreds of us, and we just were told to walk towards the Capitol and then drop on the ground when we were touched on the shoulder. And then they did a chalk outline of our body. Mm-hmm. And then we stood up, and just that silent example. And then with Dr. Barber a few years ago, we marched in Washington, D.C. about immigration rights, and we formed five abreast and walked silently down the street. And the power of that was amazing. And finally, Dr. King did the dream speech often, and he almost didn't do it that day. He walked off stage, and Mahalia Jackson said, aren't you going to tell him about the dream, Martin?
We can thank Mahalia Jackson. I love that you brought up silence, because like the fellow from Finland, sometimes stillness and silence speaks louder. Also contextually, silence works very well when you're talking about AIDS deaths, because it symbolizes the silence, the absence that can happen. It may not be appropriate for other things. And so one of the things you always have to think about is, what is the issue? What is the context? Where is the place? And then how do you adapt to that? Again, that's why I'm very, very suspicious of the one size fits all. Like, what are we gonna do? We're gonna have a mass demonstration. Maybe not. Maybe something's more appropriate. What are we gonna do? We're gonna die in. Very appropriate when you're talking about HIV AIDS. Maybe not appropriate for talking about something else. And so to always think about context, I think, is super important. But yeah, silence can be very, very powerful, especially in a noisy world. Yeah.
So I have a question. Yeah. Listening to your talk, I was reminded of examples of the use of propaganda for nefarious purposes, right?
Thank you.
How powerful that can also be, right? And that brought to my mind, like, the question is, like, there can be artistic expressions that are going to appeal to different sides of myself, right? Like the better side of myself, or maybe a side where my aggression and everything that I don't like about myself, or that I don't like, right, comes out, right? So I was trying to think about, like, what, for me, when I witness something, because I'm sure there are people who are thinking about this with a different mission, right? I was trying to answer the question for myself of, is the appeal to my emotion, like, how can we think through it in a way where we can think, is this appealing to the better part of me, or to the worst part of me, right? And I would like to hear your opinion. I was trying to answer the question for myself, but I'm very curious.
No, I'm so glad you brought that up. So when we do the history section of the trainings, we always end with what we call the dark side. The most effective and affective practitioners of artistic activism in the past 100 years was not the civil rights movement. It was not the feminist movement. It was not any movement for peace and justice. It was the Nazi Party. They thought about spectacle. They thought about style. They thought about symbols. They had theater. They had music, everything. Hitler was an artist, and he thought like an artist. This is really powerful stuff because it deals with emotions, not always with the mind. And so therefore, one has to think about the ethics of the practice all the time. So in that book that was mentioned about dream, there's a whole chapter on what I call ethical spectacle, which is like, how do you mobilize these things, but also think about the ethics of it. You bring up the sort of the good wolf, good side, bad side. You know, it is easy to mobilize people on hate and fear. It is actually much easier to mobilize people on hate and fear, much harder on love and hope. So when we worked with Greenpeace, one of the reasons they brought us in is they were worried that the environmental movement was spending too much time scaring people and not enough time thinking about what kind of world we wanted to build. And they had an ethical problem with that. You know, watching a polar bear about to be killed because it's going to fall off an ice thing is great. It heart strengths and so on and so forth. But they were asking themselves, but what sort of world do we want to build? Do we want to build a world which is based on hate and fear, and that will come back to haunt you? Or do you want one on hopes and dreams? And, you know, here my heroes, people like, you know, Gandhi or King and so on and so forth, they would always come back to that, the idea that you have to figure out how to build it on dreams. Even, you know, Che Guevara and Fidel Castro, I mean, they were thinking in terms of what is the ideal society we want to create, even if they didn't practice it always. You know, unfortunately, we live in a world, particularly, you know, Donald Trump, I think, was the prime example of this, where he knew how to mobilize fear, and he was brilliant at it. And I think you're right. I think Biden is trying to mobilize this sort of better angel model. I don't think he's quite as good at it, but someone like, yeah, I mean, I think there's possibilities there. But I think the key is, and I will end with this, is to ask yourself always, this may work, but what sort of a world am I bringing into being by using this technique and tactic? And let that guide one's decisions as much as the effectiveness of the tactic.
Yeah.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Steve. I think it's fair to say that most everybody in this room considers themselves an activist on some level. And I appreciate the way that you opened more possibility and help us think out of the box a little bit. I think it's awesome. Thank you so much.